Hello and welcome, friends. I am Professor Sunavane. In this particular lecture, which is dealing with Module 1, Part 1, I will be discussing about surveying definition, its principles, classification of the surveying, brief review of basic measurements, methods and equipment. I will be also discussing about phases of the survey in civil engineering. So to start with, surveying definition. Basically, surveying is basic operation of any civil engineering project. Whenever we wish to accommodate some structure on certain piece of the land, we must know exactly what is the extent of that particular land, as well as what is the nature of that kind of terrain. Hence, surveying is defined as, it is an art of determining relative positions of various points on, above, beneath the surface of the earth by means of direct or indirect measurements of distance, directions and elevations. Simultaneously, we can also think of leveling. So, leveling is a branch of the survey which is more related with the determination of the various points in the vertical plane. The basic objective of the survey is to prepare some plan or map. Here, let's get understood with what is the meaning attached with this particular plan or map. Both are the drawings. Both are depicting the features that are existing on the ground surface. Here, the difference lies on the extent of the land that we deal with. See here, the plan is related to the small areas. Here, we'll be usually employing the scale such as 1 centimeter is equal to 10 meter or less in order to present some small portions, say for example, the plan of the campus, plan of the building. Whereas, as we consider large areas, here, we will be adopting certain scale such as 1 centimeter is equal to 100 meter or more, and accordingly we will be dealing with very large areas. So for example, here we can say map of India, whereas plan of the building. More about this we will be discussing further as and when we come across some other features. In surveying, we deal with four types of basic measurements. The first measurement is horizontal distance. Second measurement is vertical distance. Third measurement is horizontal angle. And fourth measurement is vertical angle. In order to understand the terminology associated with each of these, please refer to this case. Let's consider this as Earth's surface. So here what you see is nothing but, so to say, mean spheroidal surface of the Earth. Why do we say mean spheroidal? Because it has got many undulations. So that undulations are brought about, and accordingly here just we say that this is mean spheroidal surface of the Earth. Any surface which is parallel to this will be nothing but leveled surface. So leveled surface is again spheroidal surface, only the thing is that it is parallel to mean spheroidal surface of the Earth. Any line which is lying in this particular leveled surface will be treated as level line. Whereas, if we consider just one point, say, station B. So here, at this point, we can consider certain surface which is tangential to that level surface. So any surface which is tangential to this particular level surface would be treated as horizontal surface. Through the point of under consideration, as we consider the direction of the gravity, it is nothing but a plumb line and it would be treated as vertical line. So here we consider any surface which is tangential to the leveled surface as horizontal surface, and any surface which is perpendicular to this particular horizontal surface will be nothing but vertical surface. So in order to measure the distance on horizontal plane, we have to deal with surface that is tangential to this particular leveled surface, and any distance such measured would be considered as horizontal distance. Similarly, any distance which is measured in this particular vertical plane along the plumb line, along the vertical line, would be treated as the vertical distance as such. See, if we consider this as plumb line related with this horizontal surface, whereas if we consider this as another horizontal surface, and accordingly this will be the vertical plumb line. So here both these particular horizontal planes will seem to be skewed to each other, but in reality both would be treated as horizontal surfaces only, and accordingly all the lines that will be lying in that particular horizontal surface would be treated as horizontal lines as such. So if we measure along the mean spiral surface of the earth, in order to express it as horizontal distance, we have to project it on the horizontal surface. Any angle that we measure on this particular horizontal surface would be treated as horizontal angle, and any angle that we measure with respect to this particular, say, horizontal line in the vertical plane would be treated as vertical angle. As we continue further with all our discussions, I think the idea of horizontal distance, vertical distance, horizontal angle, as well as vertical angle will be more clear to you. But we have to use these particular basic measurements. And sometimes as we proceed with the discussion, you will also come to know that the same distances, wouldn't it be measured in the horizontal surface or even also the vertical surface, would be expressed with different means. Whenever we deal with surveying as an operation, we deal with two basic principles which are more important. The first principle is called as to work from whole to part. Let's refer to this particular sketch. As you see, here this is the total area under consideration. In order to measure that area, in order to survey that particular area, we have established some control network as A, B, C, D, E, A. Hence, the entire area to be surveyed is expressed in relation with this, say, certain control network A, B, C, D, E, A, and all other internal areas. Further be divided into certain, say, small triangles such as A, B, F, B, C, F, F, C, D, and accordingly. So here, whatever the area that is to be surveyed would be considered with reference to the whole circumscribing network, and all that particular, say, area that is covered with that particular network would be further divided into smaller parts in order to make it survey. So here we deal with whole to part. The second principle of the surveying tells us about the location of the station by at least two independent measurements. Okay, so here, say, this is station A, this is station B, this is station C. Okay, So please don't get confused about this, because station terminology, any point with which we deal with in surveying operations would be treated as station. So here this particular triangle is telling us about station A, B, C, and thereby network defined by that particular stations as A, B, C network. In order to establish this particular network with respect to, say, station A, B, we can make use of two linear dimensions, say small a and small b, so that intersection of this small a and small b will be giving us the location of station C. As such, we are making use of two independent measurements, small a and small b, in order to define the location of station C. Similarly, here in the second small sketch, as you see, this is line AB. With respect to that, we wish to define the location of this particular station C. Hence, we can define chain edge as it is called. See here, say let's treat this as CD. So here, this CD would be considered as perpendicular offset, whereas distance A to D will be considered chain edge. So here, this CD being perpendicular offset makes angle of 90 degrees. So once we define the distance of AD along line AB, by having the distance of this particular CD, we'll be able to locate the station C. Similarly, in order to locate the station C with respect to line AB, we can make use of distance BC in addition to angle ABC. Similarly, instead of making simply two linear measurements, we can make use of, say, two angular measures, say angle at A, angle at B, and as we proceed with the directions, the intersection of that particular directions will be considered as, say, station C. Similarly, we can make use of one angular measure and another linear measure in order to define this particular station C. See, whenever we deal with any surveying operations, firstly, we have to establish control on the piece of the land that we wish to survey. For that, we have to make use of this particular principle to work from whole to part. As we do so, we'll be defining various surveying lines A, B, C, D, E, A. With respect to that, we have to define the various stations so as to have that as reference stations. Say, for example, F here. So in order to look at this particular station F, we can make use of this particular second principle. As we carry out the surveying operations, to facilitate that particular surveying operation, we can make use of number of techniques. We can make use of number of people. We can make use of number of equipment. But a particular piece of the land is in demand of some specific methodology. Hence, the third principle of the surveying can be considered as method of survey should be appropriate with objectives. Now, as we define the network, as we define the location of the stations, here we must be in a position to check whether the thing that we did is correctly done or not. So in order to do so, we can make use of, say, various checks. Say, for example, here in this particular sketch, what you see, with respect to line CD, say we have defined station F. Now, as we define this station B, small b, on line CF, we have distance CB in order to define on the paper when it is plotted. As such, distance BD measured on the ground and distance BD that is plotted should tally with each other, or it should be lying within the acceptable margin of the, say,
mistake that we did, error that is committed. So here all such checks on the work will define us to, will help us to apply the check on the work. Another example, say we have defined this particular station BCF in order to create certain plane triangle BCF. Being plane triangle, the sum of input angles should be 180 degrees. Say, if angle B is 60 degrees, if angle F here is 60 degrees, obviously angle should be very close to 60 degrees at C. So here, as such, the knowledge that we have that included sum of the triangle should be of 180 degrees. We are applying it there, and accordingly, here we'll be going for that particular say checks as such. Fifth principle is also very important. Whatever the work that we do here on the field, it cannot be memorized simply. It should not be person dependent. It should not be time dependent. And hence, here we have to prepare certain notes on certain, say, papers, and we have to create some field book as such. So that particular field book will be giving us appropriate entries for all the references of not only the surveyor who did the work on the site, on the field, but in addition to some other people who would be referring to that particular work, say maybe in the future or maybe in the immediate future while preparing that plot. And that's why here this particular principles of the surveying is very important. This is very important to observe as far as, say, surveying operations are concerned. Now, surveying can be basically classified in two types. One is plane survey, and the second one is geodetic survey. To start with, plane survey is related with plan, whereas geodetic survey is related with certain map. You are already conversant with that particular plan and map, and hence I am trying to attach the classification of the surveying as plane surveying and geodetic surveying with that particular terminology. Let's speak more about the plane and geodetic surveys in subsequent slide. So here what you see is certain small area, and that small area is established with certain control network. Further, it is divided into smaller parts. Certain check lines are defined. Certain buildings are defined with respect to the offset, with respect to that particular, say, measuring line as such. Certain tree locations can be again considered with respect to, say, perpendicular or oblique offsets. More about this we'll discuss later. So here the area to be surveyed is small. Now, one more thing is, you know this, Earth is nothing but spheroidal in nature. It is spherical in shape. It is big enough, it has got big diameter, so that if we consider just a small portion of that, that small portion could be considered as plane area. And hence, the spheroidal shape of the nature can be neglected. Hence, here, whatever the area that we wish to survey as plane survey, though in reality is lying on the curved surface of the earth, the area to be surveyed, being small enough, will be neglecting the curvature of the earth's surface, and hence that particular survey would be brought under plane survey nature. Here, as you know, as we establish the control on that particular, say, piece of the land to be surveyed, we wish to define that particular area into this particular number of triangles, and accordingly we'll be collecting the data either in form of linear measures or angular measures. As such, we are forming certain surveying lines as well as we are forming certain horizontal angles in order to represent that particular terrain on the piece of the paper in the form of plan. So here as we consider the number of cerebral lines, though that are forming or that are lying along the cerebral lines, having the area under consideration very small, the cerebral lines would be treated as straight lines. As well as we consider these proprioceptive lines, in earlier presentation, we saw that level surface creating surface tangential to it to be expressed as horizontal surface. Any surface perpendicular to it will be nothing but vertical surface. So for a given level surface, there will be infinity number of horizontal surface as well as infinity number of vertical surface. But the thing is that here, that particular surfaces, vertical surfaces, will be meeting at the center of those surface. Whereas, as we considered here, the plumb lines, the concept of the level surface itself is getting transformed into the horizontal surface. Hence, the plumb lines would be perpendicular to that particular horizontal surface. Perpendicular to that particular horizontal lines, perpendicular to that particular horizontal surfaces, but essentially it would be treated as parallel to each other, though in reality they are not parallel to each other. Just as a guideline, you can assume this particular, say, figure of 260 square kilometers. Okay, but if we consider such a narrow strip which is having, say, length of 1 kilometer and or rather width of 1 kilometer and length of 260 kilometer in order to express that area of that particular 260 square kilometers, it won't be treated as plane surveying because the length involved is so much, and hence we have to consider the curvature of the earth surface. More about this particular concept would be discussed as we proceed further. Next part of the surveying as a basic classification is nothing but geodetic surveying. As we considered earlier, it deals with larger areas. Usually, this kind of works are carried out by government people. For example, in India, these kind of works are treated as great trigonometrical surveys, and this is done by Survey of India. Here, the basic difference is curvature of the Earth's surface is taken into account because we are dealing with very large areas. The drawings that are prepared by making use of this would be considered as map. So, here the objective is to determine the precise position on the surface of the Earth of a system of widely distant points which form control stations in which survey of less precision may be preferred. In the simpler words, geodetic survey creates some precise network of well-established points, stations on the Earth's surface so that we can make use of that network for further works which could be conducted on certain smaller scales. So here, as we thought of level surface, any surface which is parallel to mean spiral surface of the earth, lying on this particular surface will be nothing but level line. In geodetic survey, we take into account the curvature of the earth surface. Hence, the any side of the triangle would be nothing but curved line. And accordingly, here set up such surveying lines for certain spherical triangle as it is called ABC will be having the sum more than 180 degrees. Here, in order to consider the area to be served by using geodetic principles, we have to have it more than 260 square kilometers. The way I mentioned earlier that 260 square kilometer is just guide figure. we cannot consider 1 kilometer by 260 kilometer area belt as plane survey. Even there is secondary classification. In fact, we can classify these particular surveying operations in many ways. Here, as you see, the secondary classification can be done through various aspects such as nature of the field, object of the survey, instrument used. So, say if we are working on this particular land and we wish to determine the topography of that particular land, the survey would be treated as topographical surveys. If we are dealing with certain water bodies, say for example, if we are dealing with marine, if we are dealing with certain ocean, so accordingly, it would be treated as hydrographic surveys. It would be brought under marine surveys and accordingly. Similarly, there may be a necessity to explore some piece of the land at beneath the surface. Say for example, it could be mining activity, it could be certain say soil exploration program, it could be certain say part of this particular archaeology in order to open up certain relics of the past. So accordingly, the survey would be considered as this particular based on nature of the field. Similarly, in order to deal with piece of the land, we can have the photographs taken from the surface itself or otherwise from the certain elevated positions. So accordingly, such kind of the surveys would be considered as photogrammetry, and accordingly that would be considered as photographic survey. Object of surveying, in fact, is huge scope. Say for example, if we wish to establish the control, if we are dealing with city, if we wish to determine the topography, if we wish to deal with cartography, more about this in subsequent discussions. If we wish to define the route network as we define certain mine,
if we wish to plan military strategy, we wish to work out certain geological features, their extent, if we wish to determine the heavenly positions. See, here, based on object of survey, the survey could be considered as control survey, city survey, topography survey, and accordingly. Don't get confused that here also we are talking about topographical survey, as well as here also we are dealing with topographical survey. In survey, we cannot make these as hard and fast separation. In order to determine the topography of the land, we wish to deal with land, and that's why this kind of a survey is brought under land surveys. Here, our objective is to determine the topography, and that's why here it is topographical survey. So, to understand better, let's consider that we wish to have engineering survey. We wish to collect certain terrain data for planning, design, and execution of certain, say, engineering projects. Say, for example, we are dealing with certain dam as such. So, where the proper dam should be located? We must know what are the suitable site conditions, what are the availability of the infrastructures. So, we will be having certain, say, preliminary screening, and that kind of the survey would be treated as reconnaissance survey. So, here it deals with just very crude methodology, which will be furnishing more information about the piece of the land. As we have collected that proposed crude information, it could be further refined in order to collect certain adequate data to prepare plan or map that particular area, in order to plan or design that proposed dam structure, as we consider it as an example. So here we'll be dealing with preliminary surveys. When we enter into the execution mode in order to start actual construction, in order to execute that proper project, we wish to set out it on the land. So here we'll be going for location survey. So here the basic objective is to carry out the engineering survey. We wish to construct that dam for this particular example. So again, this particular engineering survey will be brought under different classifications as a reconnaissance, preliminary, as well as this particular location survey. The third category of the survey can be instrument-based survey. So here, whatever the equipment that we use, say for example, we make use of chain in order to determine the linear measurements. So as we are making use of chain, it will be treated as chain survey. If we wish to determine the bearings, if we wish to determine certain say angles by making use of compass, then the survey will be considered as compass survey. We can club in making use of chain as well as compass. So accordingly, here there will be chain and compass survey. So similarly, as you see, there will be plane table survey, leveling survey, theodolite survey, tachometry, and so many categories. So we'll be discussing each of these in depth as we proceed further. In order to have the surveying done, we have to follow two basic approaches, two basic methods. So these two basic methods are dealing with the plane with which we deal. So here we have to define the fixing or where we should determine the positions of certain station in horizontal plane. Hence we can go for the methodology such as intersection, we can make use of angle and distance, we can make use of resection. Similarly, in order to fix or to determine the position of a certain station in vertical plane, we can make use of ordinary leveling, we can make use of trigonometric leveling, we can make use of even certain barometric leveling. Here, certain terms are new to you, but very objective of this particular presentation is to introduce the scope of survey. Hence, I am not discussing further about these particular set terms, but as we proceed further, each of these particular terms will be discussed in depth. There are lot many equipment that we adopt to facilitate survey operations. Say for example, in order to measure certain linear dimensions, we can deal both in horizontal plane as well as the vertical plane. In order to measure the distances in horizontal plane, we can make use of, for example, chain, tape, steel bar, certain ADM equipment. Similarly, in order to measure certain vertical distance in vertical plane, we can make use of level, theodolite, tachometer, as well as certain ADM and so many advanced equipment. Similarly, in order to have angular measures both in horizontal planes as well as the vertical planes, we can make use of range of such equipment. Depending on the class of the work, the way we considered for engineering surveys, we can conduct reconnaissance, we can conduct preliminary work, we can work detailed survey, we can conduct location surveys, subsequently we can conduct certain check surveys. So all that particular say methodologies are in need of certain specific instruments. Even while plotting, we have to have certain, say, specific instrumentation. So, here, the kind of the instrument that we make use of for surveying operations can be broadly brought under these two categories. One is major equipment and second one is minor equipment. This minor equipment has very small, tiny, handy equipment which can be carried in the pocket of the surveyor, and accordingly, that will be giving us poor idea. So here while carrying out our reconnaissance work, these particular equipment which are treated as minor equipment will be very important. Here, these particular equipment will also be discussed in our subsequent discussions. There are certain basic techniques in surveying. One of the terminologies that I used to discuss some establishing the control, we consider that particular network A, B, C, D, E, A as such. So that particular network A can be considered as traverse. So here, as you see, this is the piece of the land that we wish to deal with. So accordingly, here what we have is network A, B, C, D, A. So, here, this helps us to have certain closed towers as A, B, C, D, A. Similarly, say for example, if we are dealing with certain say road work, so it won't help us to have certain closed towers as such. Instead, we can go for certain open towers. So here, as you see, certain survey line AB, BC, CD is forming certain network ABCD. As such, it is open towers. Similarly, there can be another technique which is termed as triangulation. Here, as you see, the terrain under consideration is divided into number of triangles. With respect to certain baseline, as it is called, the entire network of the triangles is having relation with that. We make use of just one linear dimension and we make use of other angular dimensions at each of the stations so as to work out the set of dimensions as we proceed further. So this is triangulation technique. In triangulation technique, we just work opposite to triangulation. That is, we make use of one baseline in addition to two sides of the triangle, and we have to make use of one angle at any of the favorable station, and by making use of three sides of that triangle and one angular measure, we will be working out the data related with the subsequent chain of the triangles. So here, this is trilateration technique. Again, we have to discuss, in fact, we will be discussing more about this in our subsequent presentations. This surveying operation is technical process. It needs to be carried out precisely, accurately. Hence, we have to carry out very detailed operation. It involves very precise measurements. It involves state-of-art technologies. So, firstly, we have to think about the exact scope of the work, the kind of the instrumentation that is required, the kind of the people that are required, kind of the funding that is required, kind of the equipment that we can involve in, the probable time spans that are related with that work. So here, this is the first phase of the surveying, that is nothing but office work. Herein, we'll be having all the things worked out in office to deal with actual field work. Based on the strategies that are defined in this particular say office, we'll be carrying out that particular say field work as reconnaissance, preliminary, detailed, established location work and as such. As we collect the data on this particular say field work, as we come back, the next thing is compilation of the data. As we compile the data, we'll be facing certain problems. If there's a need of omitting certain measurements, we have to make use of some other means in order to generate that particular data. So the kind of things that we do playing with the data, again in the office work, there is, in fact, it is continuous loop to work from office to field, compilation of the data in office, further go back to say that particular field, so that the entire objective of that particular survey operation will be facilitated. So this is just a broad overview of the surveying operations, various principles, as well as the instrumentation that we'll be using. So basic methodology as such, already we have discussed in terms of traversing, triangulation, trilateration. Being that as basic techniques of surveying, we'll be speaking more about that in subsequent lectures. So thank you for your attention. Bye till then. I wish you very happy learning. Thank you.